Hello, ladies and gentlemen. This is Randomised Gaming's now playing look at Zelda the Breath of the Wild, or Breath of the Wild. I keep adding a the before it. But this is the newest Zelda out now. It's been out for a week now, and we've actually been playing the Wii U version. I'm your host, Random Gamer Riven, and I'm going to give my thoughts so far on Breath of the Wild. Certainly, it's been a very hyped up Zelda, and indeed, if you watch a lot of the YouTube reviews, you'll be inundated with comments and feedback of the game. Don't worry, there's no huge spoilers in this game. We're only going to take the video itself is only going to show you the first hour roughly of gameplay, just slightly under the first hour of gameplay, so it doesn't show you that far, and it's nothing you won't see past the first hour. We didn't want to go spoiling loads and loads of content for you. I know some people have already extensively played through it. Indeed, there were people streaming it the day before it officially launched, trying to finish it as quickly as possible. But unfortunately, I'm not mean and really want to do anything like that. Now, the game also has a season pass, and you can also download that if you're interested. And that adds in, at the minute, just three chests, but one of them has a Nintendo Switch t-shirt. Now, the reason I actually want to give a talk about, I was just going to give you a quick original talk about the first hour. However, the original record, while I was recording this, someone forgot to press the record button. And so the dialogue wasn't, the commentary wasn't saved. That might have been me. But I thought, well, seeing it's been out for a few days, you know, I'm actually going to just provide commentary on what I think of the game so far, so that people can decide whether roughly this is the game for them or not. Because even as I found, the longer I've played into it, my opinion has changed somewhat. I think a lot of people initially had a bit of hysteria when playing the game, thinking, wow, this is the best Zelda ever made. It's got lots of changes. And actually, no, not really. It's kind of more a throwback to the original Zelda and cross between Wind Waker and the explorative side. So it's more like the earlier games, but there is largely a lot of new open world mechanics, such as the ability to pick up weapons and things that previously, I mean, you can just literally pick up almost any weapon and use it. There's tons and tons of weapons, although they do break overly quickly, it has to be said. But basically, the game itself is quite a, in many ways, it's quite different from some of the more formulaic ones. I suppose Ocarina of Time is the game to blame for the rather formulaic format. So I'm just going to be silent here for a bit while the VO starts off with the actual opening intro, just so you can hear it.
Open your eyes. Open your eyes. Wake up, Link.
Now, unlike some of the more recent Zelda, such as Skyward Swords, the game throws you into the action practically instantaneously. It really is nearly NES leveled and SNES level of throwing you into the action, which is very, very refreshing, it has to be said, because Skyward Sword had something like 30 odd minutes of cutscenes before you really got into the game, and even things for the Krina and Majora's Mask started to introduce quite heavily cutscenes that weren't necessarily needed and didn't add a lot into the gameplay. Cutscenes can be used to great effect, but they need to be done right, and Nintendo have always struggled a bit telling stories particularly well. Zelda traditionally is boy saves captive girl, and Nintendo have struggled to move away from that format. Even in this game, there is still an element of boy saves captive girl. I really wish it would be nice, actually, if Zelda was for once a playable protagonist. you know, the actual Legend of Zelda actually had a game. I mean, there have actually been games where you played Zelda, but as far as I'm aware, there wasn't any official Nintendo ones. The two Philips CD-i games did allow you to play as Zelda, and I kind of feel perhaps it would be nice if they did a flip side of it and actually had you playing as Zelda much more fluidly and more openly in one of the games. Maybe you just have a whole game where Zelda was trying to save Link, or doing something where Zelda and Link have to work together from the get-go. A bit like, I suppose in many ways, a bit like Spirit Tracks, but where you could actually play as Zelda in Spirit Tracks. Zelda is literally just a ghost because she's lost her body. But there are a few... Traditionally, Zelda is quite a bad character in many aspects, and they really never really developed their relationship particularly well. Now, Breath of the Wild, as you can see, is very much open world. For starters, you're no longer predefined by the equipment. You can basically pick up and buy a lot of equipment from... There's a lot, basically, from as you'll go along. So there's lots of different shops that sell different types of equipment. Some stealth, some more for defensiveness. It's much more in many ways, although this is open world. Some people are saying Skyrim and stuff. I would argue there's a lot more Dark Souls in this. I think they've really been looking at Dark Souls and Monster Hunter more than I'd say the open world games like Skyrim, Morrowind, Oblivion, etc. But there are elements of that. There's also quite a bit of Assassin's Creed, I felt. They've really looked at a lot of other games to try and improve it. And one of the reasons for all these improvements and change the series is, unfortunately, I suppose in many ways unfortunately, is basically because Skyward Swords bombed. Skyward Swords, in comparison to the other Zelda games, really did bomb. Primarily, that was Nintendo's fault in using the awful motion controls of the Wiimote, and they really hampered the games, quite sadly. I mean, it was not a bad game, but you just wanted the standard controller, not the controllers they gave you. Up to the pedestal. That will show you. Now, before I say any more, I should say that this game does also have motion controls. They're not commonplace. So, for instance, I was using the Wii U Pro controller majority through this video, but later on, certainly in certain shrines that I've seen, you will have to swap to the Wii U gamepad, and that's infuriating. It isn't even mentioned on the box, but it is actually required. There are certain puzzles that basically require you to use the motion controls, and as always, they are pretty terrible because you have to rotate the pad around and it's not quite clear where it's centered and ugh. And that was one of the things that I got really annoyed about. And I wouldn't have, when I initially done this commentary, I was like, yeah, it was quite interesting. There's some changes gameplay here.
You are the light. Our light. That must shine upon Hyrule once again. Now go.
They're just letting the voiceover commentary, but yeah, the motion controls are slightly infuriating when you do actually get to them, and I was somewhat annoyed to see that they were still being used, even if you're using a pro controller. So that's already a slight negative against Breath of the Wild that I originally didn't see in this video. So I was just sort of giving my initial thoughts. As it looks, I mean, there's a nice, like, a very cel-shaded style of art to a lot of the characters. And it reminds me in many ways of Wind Waker with the cell shading. Interestingly, it's more cell shaded like the original version of Wind Waker than the sort of gradient mock version that was done in the HD remake on Wii U. Now, this is played at 1080p. I know some people have been saying it's actually running at 720, but scaled up at 1080, it does look very nice. And for a Wii U game, it does look very good. It is a little bit bland, however. Although it's got a big environmental world, it is slightly bland. Now, admittedly, the first hour, it's really very impressive. And playing it, it's very refreshing in comparison to the previous games. It's got a lot of good things going for it, and I'm enjoying playing it. It has, however, got more flaws than it should have, and in part I feel that's down to the fact that Nintendo don't have a huge amount of experience doing open world games. I mean, there are barely any open world games I can think of, and probably the most recent one they kind of done, although it's not Nintendo in-house, was Xenoblade Chronicles X, which did use open world mechanics with how you travel around the game. That was Monolith, and apparently Monolith have some involvement in Breath of the Wild, but Monolith again made a lot of mistakes in Xenoblade Chronicles X. The design of the open world didn't quite work as well as it should have done. There are only 5 areas, and if, like me, you went off exploring quite early on, it was pretty quick, easy in the storyline to actually, without even progressing the storyline to find the main enemy base, which kind of then made the whole plot of the game laughable because you know exactly where it is, and surely you just want to go to your commander and go, yep, boss, we need to go here. And yeah, that was probably one of the reasons why Xenoblade Chronicles X, I found its story fell flat on its foot. So you can see there, running around, it looks impressive. There are some frame rate issues on the Wii U. I mean, there's been some quite heavy debate. Interestingly, a lot of the frame rate issues depend on how you're rotating the camera. Certain angles will cause the frame rate to dip quite suddenly. Other times you can just tweak it left or right slightly and the frame rate will be gone. For the most part, it does keep up with a smooth 30 frames a second. This is not in any way, and as far as I can tell, it's locked at 30 frames. It doesn't go any higher. Indeed, all the other comparison videos I've seen have all been testing it. Clearly, it's 30 frames a second. So you can see there, one new mechanic is literally just to pick up anything going as a weapon. As you see there, one of the opening weapons you can use is a tree branch, and it's quite amusing. Literally, you can steal the enemy weapons, as you'll see later on, so it's actually quite refreshing just to be able to start fighting one thing, your weapon breaks, you pick up something else and use it. Now, one of the caveats that you'll see is weapons do break incredibly easy. Now, at first I just assumed it was going to be based on the level of the weapon, so I thought, well, a tree branch would break pretty quickly, but despite getting more powerful weapons, they still break incredibly quickly. But as you can see there's lots of wildlife as well. There's a sort of squirrel running around. There's awful lot of animals, some really beautifully done sort of sceneries. You can actually hunt animals, the sort of materials like raw meat to cook and eat. And you can also use dogs to fight, and dogs can hunt down locations for you. There's lots of cows in the sort of civilian areas. And you see things like goats as well, and just lots of animal. You can of course ride horses in this as well, which is another really nice touch. Indeed, you can actually unlock Epony if you have the Link Smash Bros. Amiibo. Although I wouldn't necessarily advise doing it unless you don't want to, unless you don't want to break the horse mechanics, because Epony's a legendary horse, so he's really high stats. So if you use him, he breaks. There's kind of a mini game catching horses and stuff, which it kind of breaks if you use the Epony Amiibo. So yeah, some of the physics are absolutely fantastic. In fact, as you see there, I'm just going to push that boulder and then watch as it rolls all the way down the hill and then some. So the environment, how the physics work, look fantastic. So there's the boulder rolling down the hill all the way down. That's really nice to see. That's nothing you would have seen before in a sort of Legend of Zelda game, because that's three physics. I could have pushed that boulder anywhere. It could have rolled in any direction, depending how I pushed it. So it's very refreshing to see a Zelda game. Now, one of the other core things is the fact you can literally pick up a huge array of materials, and you can also cook them and eat them as well. I don't believe I showed any cooking in this early start, but well, I didn't show any cooking. Certainly, you can. I've probably eat a few items along the way. So there's a baked apple. Now, this NPC, the minute I saw him, I realised instantly, because of how they'd done legacy NPCs, who exactly it was. I'm not going to spoil it in this trailer, but it's very obvious he's a key Zelda NPC from the various previous games. It has appeared in countless games. And that's the one thing I kind of wish Zelda would tweak some of the character design a little. They often look too similar, so you can tell instantly. And it kind of spoils the story. This one feels a bit bolder, and I feel they should have perhaps changed some of the appearances of some of the classical characters, so that way they're not so obvious, should we say. Because he's a very stern, leadership-like person, this NPC. And that beard reminded me very much of a certain character in The Wind Waker as well. And instantly I thought, yeah, that's probably that character. And indeed it turned out it was. So the environmental design is absolutely stunning, as you can see here. The fact that just everywhere you go, there's just a huge, it's just massive. My gripe with it being, however, because it's so large, is that it's a bit dense. There's not much here. It's a huge environment to travel, but there's not a lot of interesting designs. In many ways, I still prefer the open world of A Link to the Past, because although it's not necessarily a big open world, there's still lots of different variants within the open world. So yes, it's a little bit restricted, but the map in Zelda A Link to the Past, you've got desert, you've got mountains, you've got some really nice little, like the Zofra waterfall. This feels like they've just taken that and just expanded on certain areas. So there's huge amounts of grassland, and it gets pretty boring after a while. I have to admit, I've been getting a bit tedious because the design is a bit bland in the environmental stakes. It needed to be fleshed out a bit more. Well, the first few hours, I was literally blown away. The more I played it, the more I realised, hang on, I'm just seeing field after field after field, or slightly rocky mountain with a bit of grass on. Yes, there is a few varying degrees, like there's a bit early on, you have to climb a snowy mountain, but and a few other things, but it did feel like a lot of the time there was just grassland, and it felt like there should be a bit more than just standard grassland. So the opening part of the game is set in the Great Plateau, and you can't leave here until you get a specific item that will actually be seen slightly towards the end of this video. But basically, this is a nice sort of tutorial area that teaches you roughly the basics of how the game works, which is quite nice. It's kind of reminiscent of the opening original, like Link to the Past and Ocarina of Time, I suppose, where you get the three they have to do the three dungeons before the story progresses, which kind of have been a staple for a lot of the early Zelda games. Admittedly, size-wise, I'm not convinced how big this game actually is, although it's huge to explore. Dungeon size, it's certainly the smallest. I mean, the largest dungeon size game still remains Link to the Past by a country mile. It had seven main dungeons, eight with Ganon's Tower, and you had the three in the Light World, and technically the Hyrule Castle in the Light World as well. So it actually had 8, 12, 13, 14 dungeons. Now, no Zelda game has ever been a Link to the Past, has been as big as A Link to the Past. And in that respect, it's kind of a little bit embarrassing that the really nice dungeon design that was seen in A Link to the Past, where there was so much variety, has been gone from a lot of the later ones. I do blame Ocarina of Time for a lot of the faults in the series, because you did A Link to the Past, the Nintendo did Link to the Past, which is a brilliant game. Then they did Link's Awakening, which was a very different, very, very intelligent Zelda game. Now, Ocarina of Time, which is probably one of my most hated Zeldas. Yes, it's a very popular one, but it didn't do anything particularly well. It just kind of, it was, they admitted later on, the designers, they just copied Link to the Past because they didn't know what to do. And they turned it into the 3D. And aside from adding in a horse, all it did was actually detract from a lot of the gameplay elements seen in Link to the Past. So Ocarina of Time was a step back, but because for a lot of people that was their first engagement in the Zelda, the series got, a lot of people saw that as a high, even though it wasn't really a high. And because of that, Nintendo copied the design of Ocarina of Time overly much and didn't really look back at Ocarina of Time's flaws and say, well, actually this was much better in Link to the Past and Link's Awakening. By far the pinnacle of design in the series still remains Link to the Past and Link's Awakening, both of which are basically beautifully designed games, certainly in the smaller size. I think the open world Nintendo still struggled with, and although they do a lot of things much better in Breath of the Wild compared to previous games, this does have problems. I think primarily it's just, as I said, Nintendo's inexperience of making a Zelda game as an open world. Basically because Nintendo haven't done many open world games, and this is their core problem with it. So you see here, there's the goblins, and you see I've grabbed the bow goblins. I've grabbed the woodcutter's axe as well. So already you're picking up weapons, and it's great to actually see all that sort of experimentation with it. You can also collect like things. When you kill enemies, you'll get parts, so you can then cook them or then mix them into items. You can actually use them as well for upgrades and things later on. The Great Fairies allow to use upgrade your armor and equipment, so it's much more free-flowing as well. So you can choose what armor and equipment you want to upgrade this time around. It's not traditionally where, like in Link to the Past and a lot of the earlier Zelda games, you were pre-struck where your armor would be upgraded as and when you did specific requirements, and then the upgrades were permanent. And here you can take, which if you like a piece of armor, you can keep it till the end of the game. in effect, and that's really nice and refreshing. And I think there are a lot of good steps forward in this game. It really is certainly the best Zelda I've played in a long time of how it's designed in many areas, but it does have a few flaws. And I will say now, I have think there's been a lot of what I describe as Zelda hysteria, where people have been going for the first few hours and days, and they review a game on like their first day playing it, which is never a good idea because your opinion can change after you've played it for a few more hours. I always find my personal opinion, if you're going to fully review a game, you should always play through it to its entirety. You shouldn't just go, wow. I saw one review of one of the YouTubers who had clearly been paid for by Nintendo. I mean, all right, Nintendo want to sponsor YouTube, so that's fine, but a lot of the YouTubers need to make it much more clearer where they're saying, you know what, Nintendo endorsed me. They've given me all this content. And he was just like, yeah, this game's brilliant. Mentioned a few of the flaws and actually, there's a lot more flaws than what you're talking about. One of the big issues, as I mentioned, is the blandness and repetition. You will find there aren't that many big dungeons in this. They're much more smaller shrines. Those smaller shrines, as far as I can see, all use the same tile set and similar puzzle layout. Yes, they use slightly different puzzles and slightly different things, but they all use the same textures and skin. They all have very dull grey. Remind me almost like a placeholder debug room, in fact. They have a sort of old figure at the end that you have to get the spirit orb from that can be used to power up, because heart power-ups, you don't pick up heart power-ups in this one, you pick up spirit orbs, and when you get four of them, you can either then go to one of these statues that you just saw me talking to, and basically you can then get that statue to increase your stamina or increase your health. So you can actually have a choice this time around. You can go for stamina or health. Stamina is for climbing, running, and a few other things. Basically, the more interesting, more high-octane activities. It's a feature basically used in Skyward Swords, and they've basically blown it out a lot more in this. And actually increasing stamina as well as your hearts together works really well. I've been alternating heart-stamina, because it means you can run faster, do things quicker. The combat's been a bit simplified as well from what I've seen, because you have so many weapons now, there's a lot more mix to it. You've got the bow as well, so instantly, pretty early on, you can choose to swap between your sword or bow in combat, and it's quite refreshing, because usually the bow's often restricted to quite a way into the game. Whereas here, you can basically, bows are like weapons, you will just pick them up randomly. There's different degrees of strength, so that's the other key factor. Is you'll find early on the weapons in this area, the Great Plateau, are quite weak. Later on they're much heavier. To just give you an example, I found a sword in one shrine that was plus 50, and I'm still only about 7-8 hours in, but I've already found a plus 50 sword and been able to take out one of the guardians from it. I was actually, because of how the combat works, it can be quite tricky, as you'll see in this little bit here. If you don't prepare yourself in a fight this time round, you can get defeated quite easily. But if you do things right, you can win even over quite tough adversaries, even with quite weak weapons. But weapons do break quickly, so you need to be aware of that. Oh, and as you see there, I just threw that down to the floor. That's one of the annoyances. The R trigger just throws a weapon, and it's slightly infuriating to do that. But you will see that you do have to be careful, because there are a lot of enemies that can one-hit kill you, as you will see when I'm fighting these guys. This is their base camp. So actually, even if you throw things like the clubs, it doesn't hurt them. In case you're wondering what's going on in the video, it took me a few moments to work out how to use the bow. It's actually hold right trigger. So this video was taken when it was literally the first playing of the game. Just wanted to get a good feel for it and just see how it played. And as you can see, as the early part of the game, it's certainly very adventurous. And there's some really nice, it's a really nice start in the fact that, as I said, you can just explore and go anywhere. It's really refreshing to see that in Zelda game. But you do have to be careful, because exploring will have, as you'll see in a second, I run into an enemy that can take me out in one hit. But yeah, it's quite different to see a very different menu this time around. Usually a very fixed menu with the allotted slots for each of the designated items. This time around, you're given a set amount of inventory space, and you can pick up whatever you want, basically, and then it's up to you to use it or drop it. You can, however, extend your inventory as you go along. Now, this guy here has actually got an absolute champion club, and you will see how dangerous this world is compared to previous Link Zelda games. Unlike previous Zelda games, there are high-end enemies quite early on. As you'll see, when the blue guy hits me, he's actually going to take my whole health bar away in one hit, because he's actually got quite a powerful weapon. So, thump, and I'm down. So that didn't used to happen in the earlier Zelda games. You did not get taken down early on by certain enemies. So it used to be like half a heart or one heart. But here you can actually get enemies. That club he's actually got is a spiked club, and you'll see I'll get it in a second. It's actually damage 12, so it's actually quite a potent weapon for such a early character. And I actually then grabbed it and then used it to womp a few enemies. But the weapons do break far too quickly. Even the really powerful weapons I've got break really, really quickly. I assume, although I haven't got to the Master Sword yet, I assume that will be an infinite durable item. I expect there will be a few weapons that are basically infinitely durable and you can repair, but it seems early on the equipment breaks far too quickly. So knowing that there's that big mean monster, I'm going to apply a slightly different fighting strategy this time around. This is actually about my third or fourth take doing it, but I eventually realised, I'm just going to grab an explosive barrel and just chuck it in there for fun, because he's surrounded by explosive barrels anyway. There's some really nice touches, like you will find that occasionally the enemies have left all their weapons to the side, and when you surprise them, they'll suddenly run to their weapons to pick it up. Or if you're smart, you can sneak in and steal all their weapons and then alert them, and they'll run to their weapons and realize you've taken their weapons, which is quite funny. Again, enemies also burn. You can also burn equipment as well, so you do have to be careful, because burning equipment causes it to take damage and also causes you to take damage as well. So you see there, I defeated the blue guy, and there's his spiked club. So you can see that's 12 damage, 3 above. That's actually, for the Great Plateau, that's about the strongest weapon you can find here early on. And hence why he was able to take me down in one hit. Even if I'd had full health, he'd be able to take me down in one hit with the current armor and equipment I've got on. So you have to bear that in mind with exploring this time around. You can wander off into areas where the enemies are vastly more powerful. Now, exploration-wise, there are some nice touches. There are certain things you can find. Already you've got lots of shrines to find. To mention, apparently they've been suggested in the region of about 100. There's also things like the Kuroka seeds you can find. And that character, there's basically a big woodland character, and he asks you to find the Kurokan seeds for him so he can... And you can use those seeds to increase your inventory size from each... You can give him X many seeds and then increase your... give you an extra size of inventory. And the seeds are found by actually finding the Kuroko children. Basically, they're scattered throughout the game. They're hidden in lots of areas. You can find a few in the Great Plateau as well. Basically, each of them will often hide in an area. It can literally be just picking up an odd looking rock or moving something, or even, slight spoiler, if you actually search your tomb after you've woken up a little while afterwards, you'll see that one of the Kuroko children is actually hiding in there. But basically, there's lots of them, and they're a nice little perk for just exploring. You will sometimes see, like, for instance, another case, there was a bit where there were 5 stone structures in one area, and 4 of them had apples in, and one didn't. And I just put an apple in the 5th one, and sure enough, a little Kuroko forest child popped up. So there's lots of nice little touches like that. Quite fun to explore, but it does get a bit repetitive when you found about your 7th or 8th Kuroko child. They remind me a lot of the spiders. At least they're a bit more entertaining than just trying to find where the spider is and shoot it. Scullion spiders, I should say, from Ocarina of Time. Now, certainly this is by far one of the better 3D Zeldas I've played. Although I dislike Ocarina of Time immensely, Majora's Mask did improve on the format because it gave a lot more originality. One of my problems with Ocarina is the pacing is all wrong. Basically, the actual 3D pacing didn't work particularly well. It's quite slow, it's quite sluggish, and a lot of the design is a step back because they only often would use the 3D elements. There are only like a handful of enemies on screen and things compared to like A Link to the Past. Majora's Mask was quite an improvement. Wind Waker I really enjoyed, although the game also had its flaws. Twilight Princess was a good one. Skyward Sword was marred by the control issues. I mean, stuff like Four Swords, the off-the-wall stuff's been very good. Minish Cap was very good. Oracle Ages and Seasons were also well worth picking up, although they did feel kind of like just an expansion pack to Link's Awakening. And then you got A Link Between Worlds. A Link Between Worlds is a bit mediocre. It's basically a remake of A Link to the Past swapped out into a sequel at the very last minute, primarily because had it been a remake of A Link to the Past, it would have been pretty terrible. It's not a great game by any stretch of the imagination. It aims more for nostalgia, and as a game on its own right, it's not great. I mean, Zelda games always have a set amount of polish, which is... it's hard to describe a bad Zelda game, because every Zelda game is, in fact, decent. Even Link's Adventure, the second one on the NES, has some really nice ideas and does just some really good things. Yes, it's a bit different to the other Zelda games, but it's still a very good game. Now, all the Zelda games are very polished. You wouldn't get a Zelda game that when you play it just falls apart, breaks, like so many other games released from various companies. They're always a very well put together game. It's just some of them aren't particularly very good, but they tend to have a certain degree of polish with them, so they're always very polished. You couldn't say a Zelda game was ever released unfinished. You can say they're a bit bland, some don't do very original things, some repeat stuff, but mechanically they're always very sound. So you'll never have a bad experience playing a Zelda, it's just that the Zelda game itself might not be particularly very good. Oh yes, and one point I should point out, if you were watching me, you might wonder why the video is actually quite nice and dark. It's because, for some reason, I've discovered the Elgato HD game capture is, by default on Wii U, the brightness is too far up on the Elgato. I don't know why. It really cranks up the brightness for some reason, so I've actually had to turn down the brightness quite spectacularly on the Wii U. I put it about minus 12, and then the colour actually looks far better. Usually because a few of the previous videos, if you look at our Wii U videos, there's the black's actually more a grey, and initially I couldn't work out because it was the default settings and thought, well, I'll have a proper fiddle around of it, and I discovered the brightness is just simply too high on the console for some reason. When capturing, it's basically the default settings for the Elgato are slightly wrong. You actually have to turn down the brightness quite substantially on the Wii U console, because obviously how Nintendo actually renders the output. It looks fine on the actual TV, but on the game capture for some reason it's just too bright, so I've knocked down the brightness substantially, and that seems to address the issue. So this is actually although it's a relatively minor section, this actually shows you a big fetch quest really in the game now, because basically these towers are what you're going to find to activate the map. Now, much like Morrowind, Oblivion, Skyrim, you can fast travel over the map, and once you use your once you use your stone tablet, you can activate the ruins like this. They will turn blue and then you can basically warp to their location. So there is fast traveling. One of my big gripes of fast traveling though is that if you you can't fast travel to villages as such. You have to fast travel to the ruins inside the village. And a real annoyance is the stables. Now, I don't know quite why Nintendo have done this, but you can't get your horses. Basically, there are stables where you can put, once you capture a horse, you can get your horse in a stable, and then you can basically bring the horse out in a stable and ride it round. One of my gripes is the stables are separate locations outside of villages. So if you walk to any of the main villages, as there aren't stables in there, you can't get a horse. You then have to walk to a stable to get your horse, which, and as the stables can often be miles away from the village, or wherever you're going, they can be quite in quite bad location. So often, like I'm finding, if I want to get my horse out, I then have to warp all over to some far distant land, get my horse, and then travel back to where I was, so I can then travel on horse. So hopefully, maybe there is a mechanic later on that enables you to summon the horse. And you can whistle to call your horse, but you have to be roughly within the vicinity of the horse. If you're too far out, your whistle won't work. I.e. if you've left your horse in a faraway village. Asleep. Okay, I'll just let this cutscene play out. 100 years.
The beast. When the beast regains its true power, this world will face its end. You must hurry, Link. Before it's too late.
So you can always tell, so there's a nice little cutscene there, you can always tell whether it's a proper Zelda game, whether you're fighting Ganon or Ganon's human form, Ganondorf. Now, contrary to popular belief, Ganon's human form, Ganondorf, first appeared in Link to the Past. He's mentioned as the King of the Thieves by one of the NPCs in the demon version of Kankura Village, I believe, or was it the light version? Basically, one of the NPCs actually mentions that his real name is Ganondorf, and that's actually the first time in Link to the Past on SNES it was mentioned. Now, Ganondorf, of course, was disguised as Agrim, the wizard, in A Link to the Past, but that was his human form. So that's actually the first game. However, I've never particularly liked the actual human form of Ganon, of how it looked. It always looked a bit bland, although you could argue that one interpretation of the storyline is that there aren't the different realms, is that as Ganon's got more twisted and darker, he's unable to take back on human form, which you could in theory argue is one version of the telling of the timeline, and that basically the start of the timeline is when Ganondorf was Ganondorf, and the further along it goes, he's now then twisted completely into Ganon, can't change back into human, which would make sense as the sort of linked, as the end of the timeline, I think, would be roughly be a Link's Awakening, and yes, that was a terrible death, but yeah, Link's Awakening to but very Dark Souls reminiscent that death, actually, I should say Link, technically, if you go along that timeline, it would actually be Link's Awakening and Link's Adventure would be the last two, or something like Ocarina of Time would be the start, although I know some people said they tried to create a origin story with Skyward Sword, which is arguable. Of course, you could also argue there's multiple links. Personally, I kind of like the fact that the games weren't originally linked, and the minute they started linking them direct with some of the weird subplots. Yes, Zelda 1 and Zelda 2 were linked, and Zelda linked the past. Obviously, they've always been kind of linked, but it was much better when they didn't try and directly link them, because often linking them directly, because they're different people work on different games, you kind of get a weird mishmash of a story. It doesn't really make any sense. So yeah, free climbing is in this game, as you can see there. And it's really nice to be able to actually climb sheer walls this time round, instead of only being able to climb a wall preset up. Traditionally in Zelda, you often could only climb preset walls where they had particular textures on that you would knew instantly was a climbing wall in many of the early ones. This one actually borrows, I felt, a lot from Assassin's Creed, which quite surprised me. It was quite nice the fact you could just climb and jump and run on anything. Admittedly, I do feel Assassin's Creed does some of the open world sections better than Link's Awakening, Breath of the Wild. And again, it comes back to that theme that Nintendo still aren't that experienced with open world games. There needs to be a bit more content and variety of content for what I've seen so far. It does feel a lot like you're just going through the motions. And certainly even the two villages you'll find early on in the game when you visit both, I found this to be very similar in design. Yet the residents are slightly different, but there's not a huge amount, and both are in sort of grassy, happy fields again. So I'm basically after the first couple of hours of WoW, it's really nice to play something a bit refreshing. I was beginning to get a bit, okay, is this another grass field? Yeah, it's another grass field. Let's go here. Oh, there's another Koku child tucked away here. Oh, there's a shrine over there. There's this, there's that. It's like, what else is there? I keep seeing the same things over and over again. There doesn't seem to be a huge amount of variety. I'm not actually that far in the story, so there might be a lot more unlocking as it goes along, but from initial impressions, it does seem that it's a big world, there's just not much in it. There's a lot of repetitions with the enemies as well, certainly early on. There are different variants, but you often find that they tend to toughen them up by just making them look a bit different painted, give them a different skin texture, give them a bit more war paint on their face. And a few other things. There's a few interesting mechanics, like the Blood Moon, which is an interesting one. You'll see that. I think you can even see that in the Great Plateau if you wait too long. But basically, after so many days have passed, a Blood Moon occurs, and all the enemies and monsters you've killed are then brought back to life. Until that point, I think some of the monsters stay dead when they're dead, but I think it's about five or six days in-game real-time, a Blood Moon will occur, you'll get a little intro, and then all the monsters you previously killed will come back to life. You have to be a bit wary if you're in the middle of a mass fight when the Blood Moon occurs, because that way they'll then instantly respawn while you're fighting. So if you slayed an enemy just then... Weirdly enough, the text of the Blood Moon is a bit confusing. It implies... The way I read it from speaking to one of the NPCs at a stable, that the enemies, while the Blood Moon was going on, would keep respawning constantly. It isn't, it's just that it respawns any enemies you've killed across the map. But I felt initially that it was going to be far more menacing, in that when the Blood Moon occurred, I was going to have to start basically avoiding fights, because the enemies would have just kept respawning. But instead that didn't happen. I felt that'd be a bit more menacing point in the Blood Moon. Instead it just restarts all the enemies, and it does feel a little bit weak. Well, actually, no, you kind of wanted enemies to keep coming at you during the Blood Moon, so perhaps when the Blood Moon was going on, you kind of wanted to hide inside, but that doesn't quite work that way. The Blood Moon doesn't appear that menacing. But I said earlier, I do feel there's a lot of Dark Souls in this game, and there is... Now, some people may gripe there is some stealth mechanics in, but it's still nice to have. And, of course, as I mentioned earlier, there is amiibo some more. The two special amiibo. So I mentioned Smash Bros. Link gives you Epony. You can also use the Twilight Princess Wolf Link, and that will actually summon up Wolf Link, who will either spot secret locations for you or will fight alongside you for a bit, and you can summon him as many times as you want. You can't summon him in villages, but if you summon him in the outside, he will run with you and fight enemies. So it's quite funny to be riding your pony with Wolf Link running alongside you, ploughing down enemies in the main field. So yes, that over there is just one of the many shrines you'll encounter in the game. The first four shrines are all preset in the story that you have to do them before you can move on. And I must admit, I did find the opening, although the plateau is a great opening area, I did feel it dragged on a little bit, especially as one of the locations, one of the shrines is a bit sort of, okay, it's over the back and beyond. And when you get up there, you soon discover that if you've not got the right provisions, you're going to struggle to... actually survive in that area, although it's a nice mechanic when you get up there. I'm not going to spoil exactly what it is, but basically you'll discover why there is a temperature gauge on the radar next to the map, and that will come into play. You see there again parties of Bogue and goblins. They're quite nice to fight again. I'm using that spike club I picked up from the other one, so the spike club will actually last me a little while, and that's mainly because it basically one-shotted all the enemies. And you see that smoking the pot there in the center. You can actually drop fruit in there to cook items as well, because there is a huge amount of cooking available in this game. It's a mini nice little side game. There's a huge variety of items to cook up, basically to restore your health, restore your stamina. Unlike previous Zelda games, you can It's not just a preset mix, adding certain items will simply or add a, like a touch to it. So you can create an elixir with like a standard setup, but if you add in an additional item, you might be able to make that elixir increase your stamina, increase your defense. So there's quite a huge amount of customization in how the potions and stuff work. So that's really refreshing in how you cook up items. That's really nice, and it's nice to see that in the Zelda game, because until now there's always been a very much preset formula of how you create items, whereas this, it's free-flowing, it's create something that you want to create and then just go. And again, then you can also wait till morning, noon, night, so you can choose what time of day you work at. At night, there are different enemies in the day. You will find some enemies rise up from the dead at night, and I don't think it quite went to night while I was doing this video, but or it might do, or it might... No, I think it was still daylight towards the end when I finished it, but basically you'll start seeing some enemies in the sort of night time as well. So overall, what my impressions are, it's good. If you have a Wii U Switch, it's certainly worth buying. I wouldn't say it's a must-have game. I'd say it's for a game on a Nintendo console, it's certainly well worth an essential purchase, because it's something that there's not a huge amount out on Wii and Switch. However, if there were more open world games, this might not be a must-have. It's good, it's not great. It does have its flaws, as I mentioned, and I think a lot of the reviews, as I've seen, or even on YouTube stuff, people have been getting a bit too hysteria, or there's also been a lot of people who I think perhaps have a bit too much sponsorship these days and should need to be a bit more open about how much sponsorship they've had from Nintendo and other companies as well. I should point out, we actually purchased this ourselves with our own money, so we are completely three agents. Hence why I have had a slight negative tone on this, because although my first impressions were very good and it's very refreshing, the more I played on it, the more I realised actually it does get a bit bland in places. It's good. In fact, it's very enjoyable. I have really enjoyed it, but I do think there's some work here and there. The load time, certainly when you're using fast travel, I found the load times to be quite long. The frame rate doesn't bother me too much, because the dips can be quite regular in certain places, but compared to some of the other games I've played over the years, it doesn't bother me. It might bother some people, but both the Wii U and Switch versions have frame rate issues. Remember, this was built up as a Wii U game first and then ported to the Switch, so the Switch version isn't that much better. It's a tad better in some areas, but certainly if you have the Wii U version, unless you're really, really must have the Switch version, there's not a huge amount of point of upgrading. Yeah, so load time certainly... Load times internally aren't too bad, but when you're fast travelling, I found them to be quite long. Nothing game-breaking, but something you wouldn't quite expect in this modern era, or certainly the residuals. I suspect the frame rate and the load times will be fixed in patches, but it's something to bear a slight mind to. So this is the start of the first shrine, where we get the magnetism power. I'm not going to spoil this shrine for you. You have to figure out the puzzles for yourself. I think as an insight into the new Zelda game, I hope I've provided a bit more of an honest opinion so far. I think if you like open world games, this probably is for you. If you're not a big open world fan, you might want to look at other games in the series, or even pick up the HD versions of Twilight Princess and Wind Waker, because certainly this is a very different game. So give it a try, but this is certainly not for everyone. I like the steps forward Nintendo are taking with the series, but I think it needs more work. We may see that in future patches, but at the minute, I am finding so far, for every good thing for every good change they've made in this game, there are some negatives, and it does get very bland. And maybe later on in the game it gets better, but I'm going to have to wait and see. So far, my opinions still remain a little bit mixed on this one. Right, I'm going to leave you all there. I hope you've enjoyed this video. I hope you enjoyed this look at the first hour and some early impressions. And that's me, Random Gamer River, signing off for now.